Now, Senator J.B. Ejercito is saying that Go Hua Ping can be a state witness if she tells all in another executive session. Now, first, considering what this woman has done, should we even entertain her being a state witness?
Well, Karen, we had an executive session with her, and I'm barred from telling the details, but I'll tell you my opinion. Precisely what you said, the first instinct that came to my mind, this is a pathological liar. You know, yeah. She can lie to her constituents. She can lie to the Filipino people. We showed her proof and documents of her nationality, even the fingerprints, and she can tell you with a straight face that it's not her. She cannot be trusted.
This is a woman. Yeah, this is a woman who did not cooperate with you at all.
Correct. She cannot be trusted. And she already revealed the strategy of her legal team that she will now plead that she is a victim. You know? So going with that strategy, my personal take is we have to be very, very careful with the information that we get from her from the executive session. We have to be very careful that those information cannot be used to relinquish her of her liabilities and to relinquish her of her culpability in putting all of these pogo hubs together. We have to be very careful that she's not using the Senate as her shield in order to escape her liabilities. Mm-hmm. But having said that, the senators agree to listen, but we will take it with a lot of grain of salt.
Okay, because she did name a specific individual who supposedly helped them get on the boat. Okay, number one, pinaninindigan niya that they rowed two boats, right? A small boat transferred to a big boat for days and landed in somewhere in Malaysia. Do you believe first that they were on a boat? Do you believe that story?
Well, I still have my doubts, no? My initial reaction there, it's so easy just to ride a yacht, transfer to a boat, and end up in a different country without being detected by the Coast Guard, without being detected by the Bureau of Immigration, without being detected by PNP, for that matter. And we're talking about a long boat ride. We're talking about 3 to 4 days of mm-hmm. boat rides. You know? So I still have a lot of doubts in that narrative. We need to get, we're still validating the information. A lot of government agencies are still doing their investigation, and hopefully we'll find something that will prove that someone aided her in her escape.
Because she's probably, if she didn't take a boat and it was a chartered plane, she'd rather give the boat story instead of revealing the person from government who actually helped them ride the plane.
Correct. But probably that's, of course, that's her, that's probably the deal that she struck with this one. But it's so convenient. If you just listen to the story, it's so convenient just to ride in a boat and disappear. You know? And that's why we're still investigating that story. And different government agencies are still investigating that story.
Okay. Now, before we take a quick break, Go Hua Ping is charged with several offenses. I think 7 counts, if I remember correctly, of money laundering, among others. Hmm. What do you think should happen to Go Hua Ping? Do you believe she should be deported back to China?
No, she should face the charges here first, Karen. Based on the documents and based on the pieces of evidence that we presented during the hearing, she's central to the formulation of this Pogo Hub in Bamban. Not only central to the formulation and the inception, but also in the operations, because we've managed to prove that even when she was still the mayor of Bamban, she was paying for the electricity bill, knowing that there is operation in that Pogo Hub.
At saka na-raid na.
Na-raid na, wala nang license. And there's no license. We proved that there's no license. But yet, she still paid for the electricity bills of that Pogo Hub. So, in other words, she is involved in the operation of that Pogo Hub.
Oo. Kasi I was wondering, it seems that they fear more being deported to China, back to China, Because in the Philippines, you've seen how VIPs are sometimes treated in our jails.
Well, there's also, China has one of the strictest laws with gambling. Mm-hmm. And from what our research tells us that she can be put in jail in China for a very long time. And not only her, but also those people who are involved in gambling. They have they enacted a recent law that will really punish people who are involved, investment, even work. If you just work in gambling establishments, you can be put in jail. So they're trying to avoid that punishment by staying here in the Philippines. But equally, the human trafficking case in the Philippines is equally as heavy on those who violate it. So by staying here in the Philippines, she would also be in jail for a long time.
Now, you also want an investigation into the alleged failures of banks in flagging POGO-linked transactions. Any update on that, Senator? But the problem I wanted to ask you is POGO was legal for a few years.
Correct.
So, ang tanong yan, if you're a bank, why would we flag it when POGO was legal?
Well, Karen, for normal depositors like us, diba, when we deposit more than 500,000, you have to report where it came from. You have to report the source of your income. But in this case, in the case of Go Hopping, almost 2 billion pesos came to her account between 2018 to 2023 that were not reported to AMLAC. So this is a big question mark.
Do you know the bank?
Well, there are several accounts. Okay. I think there are 30 plus accounts involved. But there's also the family corporation, and there's also other corporations who are involved in this Pogo Hopping Banban. We calculated almost 7 billion came in to different bank accounts that were not reported to AMLAC. And the 7 billion is exactly the same amount that is the cost of that facility in Banban. So in other words, the money that came into her account went to the construction of that Pogo Hopping Banban.
Oh, all right. So will you be investigating that?
Yes.
Will you be calling the banks? The banks can decline.
Yeah, like, I filed a resolution to investigate this angle. And again, we don't want to be a haven for money laundering because people can get away with depositing illicit money and not being reported. We have to make sure that the anti-money laundering law is being operationalized properly and the provisions of the law is being complied with all actors, whether banks, government, but we have to make sure the compliance of that law.
Mm-hmm. And what I wanted to say is actually banks can decline a customer, an incoming customer, if there are red flags with a customer's business model or the background or the track record. That's correct.
Yeah, and it's also their responsibility to flag government. That's why there's such a thing as suspicious transaction and covert transaction reports. And these are the mechanisms to make sure that government is flagged, that money that are not traceable or not justifiable are being deposited in our system. So we have mechanisms and safeguards to make sure that we're not being used as a haven for money laundering. But again, the actors should make sure that they are complying those rules. If they don't comply, then these things will happen in our country.
And now we'll be talking about the budget. Now, Vice President Sara Duterte has said she will be attending the Senate hearing on the budget deliberations, but she will, this is her quote, will no longer attend the House of Representatives because she says only two people decide there, Speaker Martin Romualdez and the Appropriations Committee Chair Zaldi Co. So she accused them of meddling in the DepEd's classroom budget. All right. My first question is this. The House is proposing to cut the Vice President's budget by 65% from the proposed $2.037 billion in 2025. They want it down to $733 million. That's a 65% cut by $1.3 billion. Do you agree with the cut?
Karen, I don't want to preempt the discussions in the Senate, but the how we deliberate and decide on a budget of a specific agency is also different with the House of Representatives. And in my opinion, when the OVP budget comes to the Senate, and I think they've already transmitted it last week, we will look at the budget in relation to her being a vice president. What does it take to perform, to be a vice president, and to perform your task being a vice president? And we also admit that vice presidents will also have their own advocacies, you know, for example, in education, in health, and others. And we have seen this in the past, that vice president will have their own advocacies. And that's normal for political figures like, you know, senators or like congressmen and mayors, that you will have your own advocacies and you will focus on those advocacies. So from a broader perspective, we will look at that and we will see whether she has the budget to perform her task as a vice president and also to perform or to deliver her advocacies to her constituents.
Okay. Now, is this the largest budget proposal of a vice president? I mean, let's not count 20 years back, because clearly inflation has changed, right? Even the value of money has changed. Yeah. But let's say in the last three terms, for example, I mean, we've seen the budget of Leni Robredo, and it was quite sparing. That was a sparse budget. And the Angat Buhay Foundation, her advocacies, she raised with the private sector. Yeah. So is this the largest you've seen of a budget proposal coming from the vice president's office?
From based on my records, so I don't have the hard numbers now, but I think this is the largest from the last few years. But then again, the amount is not the issue here, but how you will spend the amount will be the most important facet that we'll be looking at. Different vice presidents will have different ways of running their offices, and we have to make sure that the amounts allocated or appropriated to that office will be used wisely. And that's why for me, the amount is not the issue, but where the money and where the appropriations will go in relation to the functions and in relation to the advocacies.
Okay, but is there a limitation? I mean, let's talk about this. One can't just propose a budget, decide on an advocacy, and use it. So just recently, the Commission on Audit in the hearing has said that the Office of the Vice President has already liquidated the 125 million pesos of confidential funds that they used in a span of 11 days in 2022. However, the COA did say it is beyond the mandate given to a vice president for such a budget. They said, so they issued a notice of disallowance, right? Because they said the 73 million that the VP used was to fund surveillance operations in 132 areas. So, iyan ang tanong, Senator. Yeah. You'll propose a budget. This is my advocacy. My advocacy is intelligence. My advocacy is surveillance operations. Pwede ba yun?
That's why, Karen, the hearings and the briefings are very important. I've seen this in the different agencies. Different agencies will propose many things, no? They'll propose things that they think it's in line with their mandate and things that they think will be essential to the country and to their office.
Yeah, but I'm asking you right now, should the office of a VP be spending for surveillance operations?
Karen, I have to look at that detail. No, I haven't looked at that detail. In fact, I just asked my staff to give me the deliberations in the House and also the budget in the budget of the OVP. But definitely from a bigger perspective, not only for OVP, but with other agencies, we have to look at the budget on a very detailed manner and cross-reference that or cross-check that to the mandate, to the functions as well as to the advocacies of the department.
Oh, now the vice president's point of view is pinupolitika siya. And what's sad with the Philippines, frankly, is it seems the budget of some agencies, but let's stick it to the VP, is quite discretionary, because Lenny Robredo experienced it too, right? During her time, and the House also didn't give her a good budget, right? Mm-hmm. So the truth of the matter is, budgeting for the office of the vice president is quite discretionary. Panahon lang yan, depende sino nakaupo. And your Vice President Sara Duterte alleging that right now quite openly. How can that be changed?
Well, that's really part of our political system, Karen, that vice presidents
don't play
In our system,
an executive role.
Aside from being the second highest position in the land, and aside from stepping in when the president is not capable in performing, it also derives its function and its advocacy or mandate from the president. No, for example, I'll give you a very clear example. During the time of Vice President Binay, he was given the housing portfolio.
Yeah, housing. And GMA was given, yes, DSWD
portfolio. So this type of very specific mandate comes from the president. And that's how our system is designed. No? That's why, to be honest, Karen, I filed a bill to change that system. I filed a bill to allow us to do that tandem voting, just like in the U.S., where you vote for the president is a vote for the vice president. Because in my view, this two personalities should be in line.
Correct.
And you have to trust one another. And for many years already, we've seen that a lot of time that our vice president and our president are not in line together. No, so it doesn't create this harmonious atmosphere in the country, because the two highest position in the land are not in a harmonious relationship.
Uh-oh. But then that also works when you have a strong party system and you can't just break ties with your vice president or president when things don't go well personally, such as Unitim right now, right?
Correct.
People
correct.
Voted for them as a tandem. Technically, that was an experimental. You vote for them as a tandem. And it turned out, because the roots don't run deep. So now what do you have? You have the vice president apologizing to the Kingdom of Jesus Christ followers. I'm sorry for endorsing the president. But do you think that will work in the Philippines?
Karen, you're right. No, that proposal that I made, no, the tandem voting, is only one of the many reforms that we need to do in our political system. The political party system is a major reform that we have to do. Yeah. Because we it's easy to set up political parties here, some of the political parties have very not so clear advocacies or principles, and we need to strengthen that moving forward. We need to reform basically a lot of reform our structure in terms of our political system in order to strengthen our foundations.
Okay, now here's my last question for you. We talk about reforms, and there's been a lot of discussion. This is the last on political dynasties. But in the Senate, it has been so glaring that you have family members with just 24 seats. You have a few families taking over those seats. I know they're your colleagues, they're your friends, but let's try and be objective here. You may face a Senate with three Tulfos. Once again, two Villars, you have two Cayetanos, two Ejercitos, and at one point there could have been two Binays, except Jojo Binay lost. But at the end of the day, it is endless. Families that just because they're popular, they're powerful, they are taking the Senate seats. It's no new faces in the Senate. And you know what's worse? is the same families in the Senate together. What is your take on that? Should that be reformed?
Well, Karen, it's hard for me to comment on my colleagues, no?
They're
colleagues. But my take on that is that the system allows it. And it's our voters who make the choice. And our voters are conscious of the names, the first names and the last names. And during the election, they're conscious on who they are going to vote for. So my take on that is the system allows that. And that's why we need to study the structure in the system.
Yeah. One would say, isn't it a rigged system, right? Just because the system allows it, does that make it right? Does that make it ethical?
But we need to look at it from a bigger perspective, no? From the political structure to our government structure, like what you said, no? Strengthening our political parties, because when political parties allow this type of phenomena, definitely if our political parties are stronger, they probably be the first filter and do not allow this type of phenomenon in our country. So we need to look at it from a bigger point of view. But right now, because it allows, our system allows it, and the voters are the ones empowered to choose, that phenomenon happens in our country. But definitely, I'm looking at reforms that should be implemented in our country, and we should really look at this from a very, very serious point of view.
Okay, my last question. You're three Gatchalians, right? You're in the Senate. You have a brother who's now mayor, and you have a brother who's now the SWD secretary. Have you discussed it among yourselves? Would any, at any point, can you see any of you running for the Senate at the same time?
No, Karen. We're not as a family, and as we've talked about that, and we definitely do not subscribe to that. I think it's something that we, as brothers, we don't subscribe to.
Okay. All right. Why is that? Why don't you subscribe to it?
Well, it's something that we feel that we're not attuned to that, or we're not, to put it simply, our hearts is not into that. No? So, but definitely at the local level, and I'll be honest, at the local level, we have, when we started off, we have me as mayor and Rex as the congressman. And we left it to the people to decide. We gave them full information of who we are and what we want to do for the country. And we let them decide. No?
All right. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, as always, sir. Thank you for kicking off the week with us, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian.
Thank you. Thank you, Karen.
As always.